yo, I feel like so free. Like we could like do stretches and stuff now. How's lunch? How's my hangry girl over here? Cured? Man, you know, we should have like bite-sized Snickers that I throw out. You know what I'm saying? That's like notes for the next one. Yes, yes, yes. I am, during lunch, you are going to have someone that's coming up right now, and I am so excited to introduce this next person. This next person, how can I describe him? Definitely a man of God, but he is more than just a man of God. He is someone that is fighting the fight for black and brown kids across Chicago, all children in general, but he's fighting the fight more than the community that looks like me or that looks like you. So he didn't have to step into this role in the community, but one of his biggest plights is for us. Are y'all hearing what I'm saying? Like, this is a big deal that this next speaker is coming up here because he is highly sought after. Highly sought after. He does not say yes to everything, but he is saying yes to you all because why? Y'all are exceptional. Hello? Exceptional and the future leader. So I need everyone to get out of your seats. Get out of your seat. You can put the sandwich down for 5 seconds and stand up. It's actually burning some calories. So, I want you to give the best, warmest welcome to Father Pfleger.
Hello, Aspen Challenge. Hello, 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 hello. Hello, Aspen Challenge. First of all, let me just begin by saying I don't know what the hell a 67-year-old man is doing talking to a bunch of high school kids. But I'm going to do my best anyway, because if you're a little bit crazy, I'm a little bit crazy, so we can meet there, all right? Let me say why I'm so excited to be here with you, because I believe that you are the secret weapon of the change of Chicago. If you're not excited about yourself, nobody else will. I believe that you are the secret weapon that we have not used yet and have not empowered yet to take over and to change Chicago. Chicago, in case you don't know it, it's broken right now. It's dysfunctional right now. We are the poster boy of violence all around this country. And guess what? We are the tale of two cities. Because when I leave where I live at 78th and Racine and I come to downtown Chicago, I think I'm in another state, in another union, in another country, and I think I've lost and traveled on a plane somewhere, but I'm only 20 minutes away from where I live at 78th and Racine. And it's time to say we're not going to get used to violence. It's time to say we're not going to get used to the tale of two cities. It's time to say that 78th and Racine ought to look like downtown Chicago. The West Side and the South Side should not be places that look like third world countries. The West and the South Side should look just like the North Side, just like South Loop, just like West Loop. Everything ought to be the same in the city of Chicago. And it's not because we can't do it. We haven't been made to do it. And that's what your job is. Your job is to make the city be what it's supposed to be. Understand that you are, I believe, the missing ingredient right now in Chicago. Understand something, in the civil rights movement, Dr. King said, we're not going to ever make this thing a change until we get young people involved. It was when young people got involved that the civil rights movement touched the hearts of a nation and things began to change. Remember, go back, we all know about Dr. King, but back it up a little bit. It started with Emmett Till. When Emmett Till got killed, it moved Rosa Parks. Rosa Parks sat in my house telling me the reason she would not get up and move on the bus because every time she started to get up, all she saw was Emmett Till's face. And she decided, I'm not doing this for me. I'm going to do it for Emmett Till. So Emmett Till moves Rosa Parks. Rosa Parks gets arrested, and she moves Martin Luther King. So all that went back to a child, to a teenager who set off the civil rights movement. You are the ones that have to set off the new civil rights movement. Understand something. You have the knowledge now. You have the talent now. You have the power now. You have the possibilities and the potential now. It's inside of you. And it's about time that we let it out and let the rest of Chicago see what you got. Understand something. Muhammad Ali said that a champion is someone who has a vision inside of them. Do you have a vision inside of you? No, that was weak. I said, do you have a vision inside of you? Do you have a dream inside of you? Do you have an idea what Chicago ought to look like? Well, look at somebody next and tell them it's time to get it out of you. It's time to get it out of you. The vision inside of you is something we got to get as a city and as a nation right now, because obviously many of the people who are now in leadership don't have a vision. Because if they did, we wouldn't be looking like we look right now in Chicago. So we need the vision that's inside of you about what it ought to be and not what it is. And we don't need to just band-aid things out here. We need to fix it. We need to change it. We need something radical out here. We don't just need to plant a few trees and have a few flowers. We need to transform whole communities and whole neighborhoods to change this city into what it ought to be and not what it is. Not only do you have the vision, you got the voice. You got the voice that we've been waiting for. You've got the voice to speak up and begin to share your dreams and share your visions and share the things that you believe in. You have to be, and today I just want to assign you to be, from this day on, an agent of change. What I mean by that is every place you go ought to be different because you're there. When you walk in a group, the group goes to a higher level. You don't hear me. I'm saying when you walk in a group, they ought to look at you and say, oh, damn, here she comes. Oh, damn, here he comes. You move it to another level. People can't talk on a low level where you are. And if they are, you need to leave because they don't respect you. Look at a person next to you right now and say, neighbor. You know I'm a church person, so you got to play with me. Say, neighbor, do you know how blessed you are to be sitting next to me? You are really lucky to have me at your table. In fact, I upgraded your table the moment I sat down. Do you hear me? You must be the agent of change. And one of the things you've got to change is the conversation. I know everybody complaining right now about this country and our leadership. This person we call Trump. But let me tell you something. I don't know why we're giving him so much energy. Who the hell is he? You here in this room, you ought to wake up in the morning and let him know you got to deal with me. Because I'm an up-and-coming leader. I'm the future of Chicago. I'm the future of America. You got to deal with me, and I'm not going to shut up till you deal with me. You got to change the conversation that's going on right now in every part of society. You've got to change it. Some of you may or may not know, back in 1900, that's even older than me, in 1900, the sanitary district in Chicago changed the river's current. It turned the river around going a different direction. It changed the whole river in 1900. Now, if they can change the river in 1900, with all your gift, potential, and talent, imagine what we can do in 2017. Just who's in this room. Just who's in this room. Not even talking about all the talent back in your schools, your classmates. Not even talking about, I'm just talking about this room. This room. All right, let me put it another way. In 9/11, 19 people took control of the world. 19 people with a common thought and a common goal called terrorists. 19 people had the President of the United States hiding in a bunker. 19 people shut down all airplanes all across America. 19 people controlled all the airwaves, controlled every conversation around the world. 19 people. Now, if 19 crazy people can do that, imagine what 150 on top of the world people can do right now in America. Somebody shout out, we can do it. Shout it like you believe it. We can do it. Say it one more time. Now make it personal. Say, I can do it. Say, I can do it. Say, I can do it. Couple of quick last things, then I'll stop. Because y'all still eating. And you're making me real hungry because I didn't eat shit. Number one, you got to know your greatness. Don't let anybody ever tell you what you can't do. Got to know your greatness. Believe in you. You don't need somebody else to affirm you. Affirm yourself. Get up in the morning and say, boy, you are great. You are the most awesome. Pat yourself in the back right now and tell yourself how great you are. Tell yourself how awesome you are. You got to know your potential. Too many of us are defining ourselves on what other people think of you. Nobody else defines you but you. You define who you are. You know how great you are, how awesome you are, how wonderful you are. You got to know that and believe it. You got to recognize your greatness. Remember Nelson Mandela when he was giving his inaugural speech, said, you do not help the world by playing yourself small. Don't ever play yourself small. Understand that you are the best and the brightest of Chicago. You are the best thing Chicago has right now. It's not on LaSalle Street. It's not in City Hall. It's not in state government. It's you. You are the very best thing Chicago has right now. And you got to believe that. And you got to act like that and walk like that. Don't ever put your head down. Don't ever look down upon yourself or think you're not good enough or you don't have the potential or you don't have the talent. You are more than enough for whatever is needed in this city. You have it in you now. Say, I am the best. Say, I'm the best me there ever is going to be. Now, see, you got to decide, are you going to be an original or are you going to be a copy? Be your best original and stop trying to copy anybody else. And don't wait for anybody else to say, oh, you're doing a really good job. I don't care what you think of me. You got to have that kind of attitude. It's not whether you don't tell me if I'm good or not. I woke up good. I woke up awesome. I walked out of the house and said, the lucky world got us one more day today. Amen? So you got to believe in yourself. Secondly, be willing to do the hard work. Being a leader is not easy. And it's going to demand you following your dream and your vision, even when others count you out, count you down, tell you what you can't do, tell you what you can't be. You got to do the hard work. Listen, the Cubs did not win because they weren't willing to do the hard work. They worked hard every day because they intended to win. You got to wake up with the mindset, I'm going to do whatever it takes because I'm a winner. I fight to win, and I fight until I win. You got to make up your mind about that. The Patriots, even though I'm a Falcons fan. But here's the thing that got me. The reason the Patriots ended up winning was because they had the experience to endure to the end when the Falcons looked sorry in the fourth quarter. They fell apart. The Patriots were used to winning. And when you're used to winning, you don't accept anything but winning. Did you hear that? So once you get used to winning, You never accept losing again. Even if it's in the fourth quarter of your trouble. Even if it's in the fourth quarter of your situation, you make up your mind, I am a winner, so I never accept losing. Set the agenda. Don't let anybody set the agenda for your life. You set the agenda. When you walk up at a table, y'all should be having a problem right now at your table deciding you got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 leaders here. So nobody's waiting. You all should be stepping in immediately. Everybody's a leader at this table. Do you hear me? And you got to know how to look at the person next to you and say, you better speak up, because if not, I'm going to take this thing over. You got to make your mind. When you walk in the room, when you walk in your classroom, you got to decide, I'm here to take this thing over. I'm not here to just sit. I came in to take this school over. I was just telling the Morgan Park students, take Morgan Park over. Take every one of your schools over. You need to be setting the agenda for your school, because the school is about you. So you need to set the agenda to it. Lastly, a couple last things. Create concrete ideas. We are in a world where everybody's talking. Ain't nobody doing nothing. We don't need any more talking. We don't need any more committees. We don't need any more task force. We don't need more town hall meetings. What we need is an action plan. We need action. Our city needs action. Our country needs action. So you got to set the tone. You got to set the tone for your school. You got to set the tone for your block where you live. On your block, you're a leader. You shouldn't be talking about, well, this one or that was on our block doing this or doing that. No, you take over your block. You're waiting for block clubs and caps meetings. No, you're on the block. You know, walk out of your house and say, this is my damn block in the morning when you get up. And you got to set the agenda, and you got to take over. The last thing I'm going to say is this. Last thing I want to say is this. I am challenging you from an inspirational standpoint to take over social media. Now, what do you mean by that? Kim Kardashian does something, and everybody tweeting and Facebook and Instagram about Kim Kardashian. Who cares? Here's a woman made a ton of money, ain't done nothing but a sex tape. I'm sorry, I'm just telling the truth. She ain't won no gold medals. She ain't done no acting. She's done no spoken word. She ain't done nothing but a sex tape, and she's a multimillionaire. You hear me? And everybody tweeting her stuff out. Now we got a fool in the White House, and he's tweeting stuff out. And every day, the whole country's responding to his tweet. Well, my conjecture is the reason that's happening, because we haven't taken control of the social media. What if in this room you decided next Friday we are gonna turn a wave and go viral in social media that we're gonna talk about leadership and peacemakers. So this Friday it's leadership. A week from Friday it's peacemaker in our community. A Friday after that it's about what we're gonna do in our block or neighborhood. What if we started a viral of control saying, why are we following and retweeting somebody else's garbage instead of setting the tone and loosening a wave of what we want the conversation to be in America? Let me tell you this, and I'm finished after this, I promise. About maybe a year and a half, 2 years ago, a good friend of mine named Lupe Fiasco said, I want to put together a group of about 500 poets and spoken word folks across the country. He said, I want us to form a union. And he said, what I want to do is, he said, I want to be able, when something happens, whether it's a Trayvon Martin, whether it's a Raquan McDonald, when something happens, he said, I want that 500 to say, at noon today, we're all putting something out on this issue. And then we're controlling the conversation. We're controlling the agenda. If 500 artists could do that around the country, well, guess what? There were so many egos, it never happened. So I'm not waiting for Lupe or Common or Chance or nobody else. Y'all the ones. Y'all the ones. Y'all the ones. Y'all got to come together and decide we're going to control. I don't know how they connect you all here, but maybe you can all get each other's emails or whatever and get to connect with each other. And why don't y'all start something? Why don't you decide, say, and something happens, or on a certain day at noon, everybody's going to tweet out and all their social media and all their Instagram and put some stuff out, and you begin. They say, well, who is this group that's now controlling the conversation in America? It's the Aspen Challenge Group. That's who it is. So let me close just doing this to you. Because, see, like I told you in the beginning, I'm an old man. I don't even know why I'm here. This is crazy. But I believe that this whole thing we call life is nothing but a marathon run. And it's all just passing the baton from one to another. We all run as far as we can. We pass it to somebody else. Run as far as we can. Pass it to somebody else. Y'all with me? So I want you to do me a favor. I'm going to put your hand up. Look like you're ready to catch something. Because this old man from the south side, in a count of threes, gonna throw you a baton. And what I need you to do is grab hold of it and run your butt with it as far as you can go. One, two, three. Take it and run, somebody.
Let's give Father Pfleger a round of applause.
Sit down.
Are you all fired up? Are you fired up? What I thought was funny was someone said, what's a baton?
What's a baton? I really am old. In a relay race, for instance, you get up there, Mikhail. So if I'm running and I go and I give it to her and then she keeps running and she passes on to somebody else, a baton is like a stick that you give one to another and you pass it on to keep running the race. In other words, I'm not the finisher of this race, but I got a part in it. And then I give it to my next person, and my next person, and somebody going to finish the race, but they couldn't finish it unless you did your part. So our job is just do our part. It's time for you to do your part.
I love it. Okay, we have time for two questions from Father Pfleger. Two questions. Remember, make them great, and let's show him how we have our stuff together and how we introduce ourselves. Right here.
I got a question for you. By the way, my name is Eric Cruz. I'm from Infinity High School. I just want to tell you, what do you think of the world?
What do I think of the world?
Yeah.
Lord have mercy. How long you got? I think the world is in trouble because we have allowed the wrong people to be in charge. And I think we have gotten lazy and sat back and let folks who are after power and money and influence to take charge. And I think it's just for time for us to say, if we just tell them, you sit down, because I'm standing up now. So the world is not beyond fixing. It's just waiting for y'all to stand up and fix it. So it's in trouble, but just waiting for change.
So I'm Lariah from Austin. I'm in ninth grade. My question, not like trying to be rude or mean, but I just wanted to know, why you come talk to us? Because, you know. Why did you want to come talk to us? Because, you know, we don't always get people to talk to us in Chicago because they think that all Chicago kids are bad and we don't know how to act. So why did you choose to talk to us?
Good question.
Why did I choose to talk to you? Well, let me tell you this. And I've spent two for. First of all, my friend Harold Green, he's one of my heroes. Harold is one of my heroes in life. Called me and asked me would I be open to it. Right now going on over at South Shore Country Club is a town hall meeting put on by MSNBC. I was asked to be a part of that. But being a part of that, or coming here and talking to you, MSNBC is one more town hall meeting that's going to be put on TV to discuss a problem we've discussed 1,000 times. You are the real deal. You are the real changers, the game changers of the next generation. You are the ones who are in it right now who can make the difference. As I said in the beginning, you're the secret ingredient that I think we're missing. I think what we're missing in changing Chicago, whether it's violence, whether it's economics, no matter what, I think is our young people. Because I think you got the answers. You got the solutions. You got the dreams. So I was excited to say, absolutely, I would come here. Because I want to be in the room with people who I know are going to change the world. So I'm coming here as a guest to you. I'm not here to lecture to you. I'm only here to inspire you to be who you already are.
Thank you so much,
Thank
Father
you very
Pfleger.
Much.
Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. Thank you.